spanning the globe to bring you the constant variety of sport, the thrill of victory, and the agony of defeat. In our 31st year, this is ABC's Wide World of Sports. Well, we've sampled the Burgoo of Kentucky and the cracked crab of Maryland as we follow the road to the Triple Crown. And now it's time for a bite of the Big Apple. Time for the 124th running of the Belmont Stakes, the third leg of the Chrysler Triple Crown Challenge. Well, good afternoon. I'm Jim McKay at Belmont, where the skies are clearing and it looks like everything's going to be all right. First, however, I'd like to express our thanks to Walter Bobby, to J.K. Simmons, and Timothy Drew from the Broadway cast of Guys and Dolls for that wonderful opening of our show today. However, what an hour and a half of racing we have in store for you right now. Later in the program, of course, it will be the Belmont with a $750,000 purse and $1 million bonus at stake. Here are the current odds, by the way, for that 11-horse field. This is the Belmont. Agincourt and Robert's Hero are the entry at 15-1. AP Indy, the favorite at 2-1. Casual Lies, second choice at 7-2. Something a surprise, he is favored over Pine Bluff, the Preakness winner at 5-1. Al Sabine, 16-1. And the others, Jacksonport, the long shot at 24-1. Cristofori from France at 9-2, a lot of support. My Memoirs from England at 12-1. Montreal Marty, 14-1. And Colony Light, also at 14-1. Now let's take a look at the point standings in the Chrysler Triple Crown Challenge. And by the way, we're proud to announce that Chrysler has renewed their sponsorship of the Triple Crown through the year 1995. That is good news. Point standings, only two horses in the race have a chance to win the $1 million, Pine Bluff and Casual Lies. You have to have started and finished all three races in order to qualify for the bonus. Either one could win, and in several situations, they could tie for the bonus and have to split it. By the way, Lil E.T., the winner of the Kentucky Derby, is not here. Remember, he came down with a lung infection and wasn't able to make it. The top three horses then appear to be Pine Bluff, Casual Lies, and the favorite AP Indy. Before the Belmont, though, we have the Nassau County Handicap, the latest race in the American Championship Racing Series for older horses. And for the full story on that, let's go up to Al Michaels. Al?
Well, Jim, this series was developed last year with great success. It strings together several established races, and it was strung together in an effort to encourage some of the stars of the game, the older horses, to stick around, delay going to stud, and have a chance to win a lot of money. Well, there's a $1.5 million bonus pool. $750,000 will go to the winner, to the horse accumulating the most points, and that prize last year was won by Farm Away. Now, this is the fifth race in a nine-race series over 7 months. Points are accumulated thusly. First place worth 10 points, 7 for second, 5 for third, 3 for fourth, and 1 for fifth. After four races, a look at the standings. Best Pal not here today, but he's won two races. He has 23 points. Sea Cadet not here either with 17. Twilight Agenda is in the field. If he wins or finishes second, he has 17 points, and Strike the Gold and Fly So Free are also very much in contention for that $750,000 bonus. Best Pal is in training at Hollywood Park. Gary Jones has done a tremendous job with the four-year-old gelding, and he is being pointed for the Hollywood Gold Cup 3 weeks from today at Hollywood Park in Southern California. Now the particulars for this race. The purse is $500,000. The distance is a mile and an eighth. The track is listed as muddy, but it's being, I'd say, playing closer to good at this point. The times have been a little better than a muddy track would suggest. It is drying out very nicely, and the temperature is 72 degrees. Now a look at the field. We mentioned it's basically for older horses, but a three-year-old, Dance Floor, has been dropped in, and he and Twilight Agenda are both trained by Wayne Lucas, so they go off as an entry, and they are 7-2. Silver Ending is the longest shot in the field right now at 34-1. In Excess was a big star here in New York last year. He's 4-1, and Strike the Gold right now is the co-second choice at 4-1. Out of Place is 11-1. Pleasant Tap is 5-1, and the favorite is the 1992-year-old champion Fly So Free, now 4 years old. He's 2-1, with Sultry Song completing the field at odds of 15-1. There is a look at Strike the Gold, who's had, you might say, a very checkered career and more ups and downs than a horse on a carousel. A son of Ali Dar, Strike the Gold's victory in last year's Kentucky Derby put him at the head of the three-year-old class, but the stay was fleeting. Out of the money in the Preakness, he lost in a photo to Hansel in the Belmont, and then the bottom really fell out. While his three owners feuded and bickered amongst themselves for control, the horse ran a dozen times without winning. put up for sale at a public auction and bought back by two of the original owners. Strike the Gold finally struck gold again 4 weeks ago in Baltimore in the Pimlico Special. In his typical late-running fashion, he dropped back to last in the seven-horse field and at one point trailed by 11 lengths. Sent off at odds of 6-1, Strike the Gold then began a stretch drive reminiscent of a stirring Derby victory at Churchill Downs. And there's a live look at New Yorker Nick Zito, the trainer of Strike the Gold. 5-2 on the morning line, but 4-1 on the board right now, probably because of the muddy track, which normally doesn't favor late runners.
Not for the Belmont, that comes later, but for the Nassau County Handicap, coming up right away. Dance for the only three-year-old in the race, gets an 11-pound break in the weights from the joint high weights. That's In Excess and Twilight Agenda. Silver ending there, you see his weight, In Excess. In Twilight Agenda, you saw at 120 pounds. Out of Place getting a pretty good break at 114. Fly So Free at 116. The Sultry Song getting a 9-pound break in the weights. Well, here we are with Charles Candy, as always. And Charles, it's hard to convey the size of this plan here at Belmont to the people watching at home. The fact that this is a mile and an eighth race coming up, and there's only one turn, it gives you an indication.
But it's the only racetrack in the country where they do run a mile and an eighth around one turn. They break and they run 5/8 of a mile on the dead straightaway, so it's easier to carry the speed. Makes the race seem more like a long sprint than a distance race, and that's one of the reasons we see Dance Floor in here today. He's running at a shorter distance. It'll suit him better. He's also running without Lasix, the diuretic which controls the pulmonary hemorrhaging, and it's less stressful at a mile and an eighth than a mile and a half. He gets that big break in the weights as a three-year-old against older horses, which we pointed out. And I think from number one post, we'll see him show a lot of speed. His stablemate, Twilight Agenda, is a six-year-old. Now, he's one of the co-top weights. He's a classy horse who's earned over $2 million. But he, too, is racing today without Lasix, and he's never won right here at Belmont Park. Then we have Fly So Free, who loves Belmont Park. He lives here. He seems to be getting back to his two-year-old championship form. He very nearly stole the Pimlico Special on the lead last time out, and he's just been breaking stopwatches here. This shorter distance will suit him better. Now, In Excess is a co-top weight with Twilight Agenda. This horse terrorized Belmont Park last summer, winning four consecutive grade ones, but he's been compromised by a foot problem. Still, he's going to be a factor in the early pace. But coming from off the pace is Pleasant Tap. He's consistent and versatile, and he was a good second in the Met Mile.
Okay, it's time to go upstairs now to the man who'll call the race. As always, here's Dave Johnson.
And the track record set by Secretariat back in 1973. Pleasant Tap is in. He was closing stoutly in the Metropolitan Mile. Might like this extra distance. There's Fly So Free. And Sultry Song, the horse I like, at 15-1. Jerry Bailey moving in. Dance Floor belongs to Hammer and is coupled in the wagering with Twilight Agenda. All in line. And they're off. Free on the outside, In Excess from between horses, Silver ending, and Dance Floor at the rail. Now Dance Floor along the inside, battling and taking command by three parts of a length. On the outside, In Excess is second, Silver ending, reserve now, back and on the outside, there goes Fly So Free along with Sultry Song. Twilight Agenda is right there with the leaders, down the back stretch, the entry running 1-2. It's Twilight Agenda on the outside, In Excess now bullies his way between horses, and In Excess takes the lead. Dance Floor at the rail is right there second. Twilight Agenda, his stablemate, is on the outside third by two. Then comes Fly So Free. Out of Place is next. On the outside, Sultry Song. After that, it's Silver Ending. And far, far back, the two trailers, Pleasant Tap and Strike the Gold, is absolutely last ninth as they go to the far turn. On the inside, Dance Floor leads it by three parts of a length. In Excess, challenging on the outside. Two back, it's Twilight Agenda third. On the inside, Out of Place gains a bit in fourth. Fly So Free is next. Sultry Song shuffled back into sixth position. And Pleasant Tap is closing stoutly on the inside. Strike the Gold is still last out in the middle of the racetrack as they move to the quarter pole. Now In Excess on the outside to the front. Dance Floor drops back second. Here comes Fly So Free on the outside between horses. Out of Place looks for some racing room. And Sultry Song
short lead. Strike the Gold on the outside. Now takes command. Strike the Gold. Pleasant Tap with a quick rush on the inside. On the outside. Strike the Gold. Pleasant Tap. Photo finish. But Strike the Gold, I believe, was there with Craig Perrette to win it in the photo. Pleasant Tap with a late run at the rail was second. And the final time, 1 minute 46 and 3/5 seconds from last to first. Last year's Derby winner, Strike the Gold.
Well, how about that? Strike the Gold, who had a 12-race losing streak after winning the Kentucky Derby, was the subject of very acrimonious bickering among his owners, was bought by two of those owners, Joe Carnacha and Bill Condren, at a sale just a matter of weeks ago. Since then, now, has won the Pimlico Special and the Nassau County Handicap. There's Bill Condren. He and his partner, Joe Carnacha, are the only owners of this horse now. They and trainer Nick Zito have been fully vindicated in what they've been saying all along, that there was nothing wrong with either the horse or the trainer, Charlesy.
And the fractions were incredible, and they certainly set it up for this stretch-running colt. Look at this, 22-2, 44-8-2. He was so far back, he looked like he lost touch with the field. But it was Vintage Strike the Gold. He started to pick him up, swept by the field, and caught him in the stretch. He loves the mud, and Belmont Park is his home court advantage.
Okay, well, those are the silks that this horse wore last year in the partnership. And apparently, because he wore them last year in New York, he had to wear them this year, because in the race at Pimlico, he wore different silks. But that is Strike the Gold, no question about it. It's unofficial. Pleasant Tap second, Sultry Song Song, and look at that time. We'll be back, and the Belmont, of course, is yet to come.
We mentioned that Strike the Gold was 5-2 on the morning line, and then he was 4-1 just before they went off, because a muddy track normally doesn't favor a late closer. But when you have a fast pace, as was the case last year when we saw a blazing pace and Festine took advantage of that to come from behind, this year in that very same race, the winner is Strike the Gold. And after that 12-race drought, he has now put together back-to-back wins at the Pimlico Special and here in the Nassau County Handicap. You'll see the six-horse Pleasant Tap. He'll go to the inside and come along the rail, and he's marked here by Dave Johnson, and Strike the Gold goes to the outside, and these two will wind up 1-2.
And Pleasant Tap had a lot of trouble through the stretches, out of place with the purple sleeves there, comes off the rail looking for some racing room himself, and Pleasant Tap scoots to the rail and takes the inside route. But out in the middle of the racetrack, Craig Perrette, with a strong right-handed whip, gets Strike the Gold, a New York favorite, in gear and running them all down. The son of Ali Dar, trained by Nick Zito, carrying 116 pounds. Between horses, Sultry Song, who will finish third. At the rail, Pleasant Tap, who ran a monster mile and an eighth this afternoon, gets the play spot in a photo. Strike the Gold, home in front.
Strike the Gold went off at odds of 9-2, so he'll pay between $11 and $11.80. One of the owners, Bill Condren, along with Nick Zito, with his arm around Condren's shoulder, rooting him home in a scene very reminiscent of last year's Kentucky Derby.
And last year, Strike the Gold got home in the Derby, but not in the Belmont Stakes. Pleasant Tap and Strike the Gold were 8 or 9 lengths behind the seventh horse, bringing up the rear, but the two of them finished 1-2.
Well, Nick Zito watches his horse come home and pay $11.60, $5.40, and $3.80. Pleasant Tap finishing second despite all of that trouble on the inside, $6.20 and $5.40, and Sultry Song pays $9 to show. The $2.46 exacta pays $64.80. And so Strike the Gold now very much in contention for that $750,000 American Championship Racing Series bonus. The official order of finish now, Strike the Gold wins it, a neck over Pleasant Tap, Sultry Song two back, and then out of place, In Excess, Silver Ending, Fly So Free, drop back to seventh, and Twilight Agenda and Dance Floor helping to set the early fractions, finish next to last and last.
Let's take a look at the trouble that Pleasant Tap had as they moved into the stretch. Now, here's the horse ridden by Herb McCauley out of place, who's going to cause a bit of the trouble, but he was simply looking for some room for himself. Twilight Agenda with the white blinkers there. Dance Floor, who's set the early fractions along with In Excess. Now, let's watch as Pleasant Tap in the blue and white cap shoots for a hole toward the inside, and at this point, out of place goes for the same hole. Pleasant Tap Now taken up by Eddie Delahousie, who is a marvelous rider, and he gets this horse going again and finds some room on the inside rail. Here's more trouble for Pleasant Tap. At this point, Strike the Gold, the eventual winner, way out in the middle of the racetrack with clear sailing to the finish line after 9 furlongs. Again, here's the eventual second place horse in all kinds of trouble. Pleasant Tap, what a job Delahousie did keeping him hot enough in order to roll through and finish second. Let's go to Charles C. Candy.
Hi, well, I've got Nick Zito and Craig Ferret here. They're discussing their victory, which, well, they should. Pretty exciting race. Nick, 12 straight losses. Now two bang-up races in a row. What's going on here?
You got to believe, Charles. It says it in the program. You got to believe, honey. You just got to stick with the horse. He's a wonderful horse, never runs a bad race, and he's just coming back. He did this last winter, too. You know, he ran second in the Florida Derby, came up to Kentucky, won the Bluegrass, won the Derby, ran second at Gulfstream Park Handicap, ran in the 36 Red, ran second after my horse, and then, you know, now he's won the Pimlico Special and the Nassau County. Thanks so much.
On his back, Craig Perrett, and after all that early fast traction, you're sitting way, way back there. How do you stay so patient?
Well, there again, Chelsea, you know, in a Pimlico race, it was just a situation where you don't play who's got speed and who's in there. You ride your horse the way he's good and happy, where he can give you his best. And I was just in the right places the last two times because he fired big. And today, he fired bigger today than he did in a Pimlico race, which was a big race. But today, he come home real strong.
It gives a lot for you. Nick, I have to ask you, where do you go now? Hollywood Park?
No, we stay right here with a race called the Suburban, the 4th of July. You know, honor of America and honor of Strike the Gold in New York and the whole Kentucky and America, everybody.
We got a happy crew here, Al.
And that's a very interesting answer from Zito as well, as you take a look at the fastest times in this race, 146.2 Upper Nile in 1978, and on a track listed as muddy that has just been upgraded to good, 146.3 is the time for Strike the Gold. But if he runs in the Suburban, that's not one of the ACRS races. Best Pal, as I mentioned before, is being pointed for the next race. He still leads, and these are the updated standings. Strike the Gold with 20 points, and Sea Cadet and Twilight Agenda each with 17. The next race in this series, 3 weeks from today, you'll see it on ABC, the Hollywood Gold Cup. Okay, let's go to Jim McKay.
All right, Al, you know, Arkansas isn't the biggest or the best-known state in the Union, and its governor is lagging in the presidential polls at the moment. However, horses from Arkansas have won the first two legs of this year's Triple Crown. Lily T, of course, in the Derby, Pine Bluff in the Preakness, both coats owned by Arkansas lumbermen, men who have really paid their dues in racing, Cal Partee and John Ed Anthony. Lily T, of course, isn't here today because of his injury, but John is, and Arkansas is very proud.
Way down in old Arkansas.
John Ed Anthony is Arkansas all the way. Names his horses after Arkansas places, he does. Names them for the valleys and rivers and the ridges. For some reason, he's had the most luck with the high places, like Cox's Ridge, Temperance Hill, and Pine Bluff.
See, we've had an awful lot of luck with the ridges. I guess we've named 100 horses after creeks and valleys and sloughs. No horse, Little Missouri, has ever come out of that. So I'm going to stay with the high ground, I think.
John Ed's family has roamed the high ground and the low in search of loblolly pine. His granddad, known even to the family as Mr. Garland, that was his first name. His granddad started the first Anthony lumber mill, and John Ed is the fifth generation of his family in the state. He started working with Mr. Garland at age 22 when John Ed's father died young. Mr. Garland lived to be 97. Family trees are just as important as pine trees in Arkansas, just as important as pedigrees are to racehorses. Even now, John Ed's son is carrying on the tradition. And there's another quality that trees and horses require: patience. John Ed learned it from his granddad.
You don't just go out and get a horse. You don't just go out and have a Pine Bluff on short notice. It takes a long time. It takes years. And I think the patience that perhaps associates itself with growing trees, which takes even a longer time, is important in having the patience to deal with thoroughbred stock.
Now, Pine Bluff is a town located about 30 miles south of Little Rock. It isn't what you'd call a destination resort. Two paper mills spread the smell of sulfur in the air, and a large chemical weapons arsenal is located just outside town. But Granddad built a mill here, and John Ed has a sentimental attachment to the place. And Pine Bluffers have taken to their horse with great enthusiasm. It's made everybody more proud of their city. And thousands of them signed a card that was sent to New York. a great big greeting card, Pine Bluff.
We saved Pine Bluff for a number of years until this very, very special horse came along, and I used it and held my breath. Sure enough, something good has happened.
And we can assure the citizens of Pine Bluff the postcard did arrive, and there it is. Who knows, if Pine Bluff wins again today, maybe the town will become a destination resort.
Welcome back to Belmont Park, where the Belmont Stakes post time is now a half hour away. And a look at the odds. Agincourt has a remote chance to win. Robert's Hero has none. They're both owned by Robert Perez and being held at 17-1. The favorite is AP Indy at 9-5, and Casual Lies is the second choice at 3-1. Pine Bluff, despite that Preakness victory, is only the third choice of the crowd at the moment at 9-2. Al Sabine, the Wayne Lucas trained colt, is 17-1. Jackson Ford at 30-1. Crystal Corey is 5-1, mainly because of Steve Coffin. My Memoirs, who ships in from Europe, at 14-1. The New York Red Mont from the outside is 16-1. Funny thing about jockeys and how they wind up in the winner's circle. 4 weeks ago, Chris McCarron didn't think he had a mount in the Preakness at Baltimore. The next thing you know, a week later, he winds up in the winner's circle on Pine Bluff. And it's an amazing thing. We put together an animation to show you the guys who've gotten off and on a horse who won the Preakness. His original rider, Craig Perret, rode him as recently as the Southwest Stakes in March, but had a conflict for his next two races. So Jerry Bailey got aboard and won two, but couldn't commit to another three-race package. So they put Perret back on for the Kentucky Derby, where he finished fifth. But he chose to ride Alley Deed in the Preakness. Then they tried to get Mike Smith, but he had committed to Big Sur in the Preakness. And that's how Chris McCarron wound up on him. He called Tom Bohannon a week before the race, and he said, "Hey, I understand you're looking for a rider." And Bohannon, as you look at him live, leading him to the track, and that is a live shot of Pine Bluff. Bohannon said, "You are my man." And that man right now, Chris McCarron, is with Charles C. Canty.
Well, Chris, on the 1st of April, you were casting about for a Triple Crown mount. By the middle of May, you were sitting on Pine Bluff in the winner's circle at the Preakness. What happened?
Well, I got lucky. That's all I can say. I was just very lucky to be in the right place at the right time, Chauncey.
It was kismet, the two of you, with your performance in the Preakness, but now you've got to change the venues. Belmont Park, different track, different surface. Is there a change of tactics?
I don't think so. In the Preakness, I just rode the race the way it come up, and that's what my intentions will be today. It's difficult to really accurately predict how much speed is going to be in a race, because sometimes the jocks will look at the form and say, well, there's not really a lot of legitimate speed, and you'll find out five or six guys want to go thinking that they can set the pace themselves. So you pretty much have to ride the race the way it unfolds.
All right, Chris, good luck to you.
Thank you.
Now, earlier today, Steve Coffin arrived here at Belmont Park for the first time in 14 years since he rode affirmed to the Triple Crown victory. Steve, it's always wonderful to welcome you back to Belmont Park. You just flew over last night from England, yes?
Correct, yes. I got in on the Concorde last night and had a good night's sleep. I'm feeling good, and it's good to be back.
And ready to ride Cristofori today. He's the only horse in the race who's been a mile and a half, yet he hasn't been able to carry his speed the full distance. What'll be different today?
Well, I think he's a very lazy horse in the morning, and I think that his first couple of races he needed. I think that they then tried the blinkers on him in the morning on the dirt track in Chantilly, and he worked really well. And I think that they feel that it was worth coming over and taking a chance. Obviously, there's some very good horses in the race, and the other thing that's probably against us is the track being off. But we're here and we're going to try. And he's a nice horse. He's well bred. He's actually bred for the dirt. Maybe he'll love the mud. I hope so.
American bred horse and American bred rider. Glad to have you both back here. Good luck to you. World-class riders for a classic race. Al?
Okay, Charlie, post time is 24 minutes away for the Belmont Stakes. And now it's time for our regular feature on what's new in the world of sports science and technology.
Sports and Science Converge, brought to you by AT&T, sponsor of the 92 U.S. Olympic team. Horse racing can look graceful and elegant, but with the speed thoroughbreds achieve, it can also be extremely dangerous. Now, several jockeys are putting their safety in their own hands by wearing a flak jacket under their silks. The protective jackets are made of triple laminate sport foam, and for the spinal strip of Spectra, a new polyethylene fiber that is stronger than Kevlar, Weighing less than 2 pounds, the jacket has become a necessity for some jockeys.
It does give me a little bit more peace of mind to know that my spinal cord is a little bit more protected, because that's the one thing that I think is in the back of all jockeys' mind is the paralyzation factor.
The flank jacket is designed to disperse the effect of any impact, offering vital protection to the jockey's spine, rib cage, and internal organs.
There's just so many dangerous situations you can put yourself in, especially being a jockey. Why shouldn't you take every precaution to be safe?
Back again at Belmont, where the track has now been upgraded from muddy to good. That's still less than fast. There's a look at Casual Lies, one of the great sports stories of this spring. Came out of nowhere to be second in the Derby and third in the Preakness. And for more on that subject, we're going to go down now to a distinguished gentleman at the turf. Favoring us with the white vest today is Jack Whittaker.
Thank you, Jim. And I think Casual Lies is the best named horse in this year's Triple Crown races. Certainly, it's the best rags-to-riches story in this year's Triple Crown races. And Casual Eyes has the most engaging owner-trainer in this year's Triple Crown races. Shelley Riley is a sociologist-turned-owner-trainer. And she and her husband came to New York for the first time this week. And with a little help from Woody Stevenson, a five-time winner of the Belmont Stakes as a trainer, she hit all the tourist spots in the Big Apple with the same verve and a land that has made her a Triple Crown star.
Here we go.
There went the...
Sit right there.
How you doing?
So welcome to New York.
Well, thank you.
I came here a long time ago and got... So this is where it's all about.
New York, New York, a hell of a town. Right in a hole in the ground. New York, New York, it's a hell of a town.
For the Kentucky Derby. This one fits. I really like the shoes. Those would be real hot in the paddock. What do you have to do to get your colors depicted here?
You've won the Belmont Stakes. How about me?
Well, welcome to New York, and you're in the right barn to win it. And the way your horse looks to me, I think he will.
Give me five.
Good.
For five Belmont Stakes that you
get. Now we go for six for the stable.
Right.
I like New York in June. How about you?
We're back at Belmont Park now, 18 minutes to post time, and we've been showing you the saddle cloth numbers, but here are the actual post positions. And isn't it interesting that the horses generally considered the big three break from posts 1, 2, and 3. APND on the inside, Casual Eyes from 2, Pine Bluff from 3, then Al Sabine, Jacksonport out of the 5 hole, the import Christofori breaking from the 6 hole, Agincourt and Robert's Hero, who are 1 and 1A, break from 7 and 8. My Memoirs, another import from the 9 hole, Montreal Marty from 10, and Colony Light from 11. Well, you know the story of AP Indy, of course. He is the horse who would have been the second choice to Arazi in the Kentucky Derby, but bruised a hoof the day before, was scratched that morning. Right now he is being held as the favorite here at 3-2 after his brilliant win in the Peter Pan Stakes 13 days ago. And he's a horse clearly with an international flavor. A Japanese owner, Tominori Suramaki, an entrepreneur in Tokyo, owns him. The British expatriate Neil Drysdale trains him. And an American, native Louisianan Eddie Delahousse, rides him and rides him quite well and has ridden him to 6 consecutive victories, including this one, a 5.5 length romp in the Peter Pan on May 24th over this very racetrack. And Dave Johnson, you've had a chance to see a couple of his races. What do you think of it?
Mike is Delahousse. He's the jockey who had all the trouble with Pleasant Tap in the last race. He gets a horse to relax. Just think, if he doesn't have any trouble, what he can do today with AP Indy.
Well, the crowd feels he is totally healthy. They have, as I say, bet him down to odds of 3-2. Clearly the favorite at the moment. And he will be breaking, as we say, from the inside. Let's take a look now at Christofori, a horse who was imported. This is a horse bred in Kentucky, but he's been racing in France, and the crowd likes him because he gets Steve Cawthon up.
And, you know, he's the only horse who's been a mile and a half in a race. It was his last effort. He finished fourth, and as Steve Cawthon told us earlier, he's lazy in the morning, so they put the blinkers on him in the first time in a race today, hoping that he'll be a little closer to the action.
Another import, My Memoirs. Barry Irwin and Jeff Siegel own him. They just bought him, and they think he has a chance to win because they supplemented him for $50,000 into this race.
And probably off the strength of his last race, he was in front. He dropped way back, and in a very quick stretch run, he came on to win it again, and I guess they're hoping for that kind of action today.
Colony Light, the number 10 horse, and out of Pleasant Colony.
Say, look at that. They need two grooms to hold this horse. They've got a double shank on him with a groom on either side. That means Colony Light is not very well behaved. Look at that. You don't see that very often.
Mm-hmm. Colony Light right now is at odds of 17-1.
A one-run son of a gun.
Montreal Marty is the ultimate New York horse. He was bred here, and all of his races have been in the Empire State.
And not much of a chance, though, this afternoon. A question mark at the distance. He only cost $72,000.
Al Sabin is trained by Wayne Lucas. We haven't seen him since the Kentucky Derby. Al Sabin, the number 5 horse, and he finished 6th in Louisville.
An inconsistent horse, but a great rider. Finn Guy Jr., who's won the Belmont Stakes 3 times.
Hey, you had the winner of the Preakness. You picked Pine Bluff. Who are you going with today?
I got the horse right here. His name is A.P. Indy. I don't the favorite, but I have to today. Who do you like?
You know me. I've got to find that long shot. Al Sabin. Okay. I like his first name. What more can I say? We'll be back.
We're back again at Belmont Park where the sun is shining and the track continues to dry out for the 124th running of the Belmont Stakes. The track now listed as good, but it's getting drier and drier as the minutes go by. A hot sun like this on an afternoon in June will dry it out quite quickly. Now they begin to head out to the racetrack. What a beautiful place this is. The Belmont Paddock, one of the most beautiful paddocks you'll find anywhere, ranking along with, I guess, Santa Anita and the new paddock at Churchill Downs. There's number 8, My Memoirs, comes from England, where he came from last to win his previous race. 1A, that's Robert's Hero, half of the entry. He's supposed to go out and set a pace for his teammate. And there is Colony Light, Mr. Peace's horse, John Peace, who's a member of the Board of Trustees here at the New York Racing Association.
And the favorite,
A.P. Indy. Now remember, he missed the Derby, missed the Preakness, had the injury to his hoof, but here and won the Peter Pan less than 2 weeks ago on this racetrack and won it by 5.5 lengths. Now they'll head to the tunnel, out onto the racetrack. This is when the tension really begins. We'll be hearing the bugler, Mark O'Keefe, just about now. And there they go. We'll be standing by now for the playing of Sidewalks of New York. That is the theme song of the Belmont. There are rumors that one day in the future it might be changed, but this is it for now. Sidewalks of New York coming up, as of course, my old Kentucky home, Churchill Downs, Maryland, my Maryland, at the Preakness. It's been a long route to get to the third leg of the Triple Crown. Here we are.
Of the Sidewalks of New York.
situation here in New York for the Belmont than it is in Louisville for the Derby and Baltimore for the Preakness. In those two cities, that is the biggest event of the year. Here in New York, of course, there's a big event every weekend. The Belmont is one of several of them. But still today, a tremendous crowd has turned out, despite the fact that they have off-track betting all over New York City. A crowd estimated at 50,000 has come out here to Belmont Park, which actually was built for a different day before there was OTB, and they could get crowds of 75 and 80,000 out here. There's Steve Coffin, back home for the day. Hasn't even been in a race at Belmont Park since 1978 when he won the Triple Crown on this track with a Fern. Must be kind of a sentimental day for him. Number 10, Colony Light there. Steve Coffin's horse, of course, owned by Sheikh Mohammed Al Maktoum, who had a Razi in the Kentucky Derby. And here we have Craig Parek. Congratulations on winning the Nassau County Handicap. What's the condition of the racetrack out there? What's
I tell you, all day today, the speed was holding up, and right before the Nassau race, we had come out on the track and noticed that they opened the racetrack up. You know, the way it was earlier, speed, they just wasn't stopping. We seen it where it was opened up, and I felt, well, we might have a chance now because the speed won't hold as much, and as we seen, Strike the Goal was way back, and he come running. So I think it's going to change the race a little bit now.
Change it a little bit in favor of whom? Do you have any idea?
Well, I mean, I think that the, you know, A.P. Lindy and Pine Bluff, Dance Floor, them horses are going to be close together. I mean, they're probably
not... Dance Floor was in your race.
Yes, yes, I've seen him the whole way. You know, they're the good horses. I think they're going to stay in contact with each other. Maybe Zito's entry will probably set a little of the pace, but I think after they get into 5/8 of a mile of the race, we're going to start seeing the real horses show up.
Congratulations for your two in a row and Strike the Goal. Keep it going, Craig.
Thank you.
Craig Perrett, one of the gentlemen of racing. Time now for a good look at the 11 horses running in the Belmont. Remember that the saddle cloth numbers I'll give you do not correspond to the post positions. First, the Robert Perez entry, number one, is Agincourt. He was a hotshot two-year-old who has faded since, really. However, he had a very bad trip in the Preakness, and trainer Nick Zito, who just won the Nassau County Handicap, thinks he has a big chance today. His stablemate, number 1A, is Robert's hero. He's really in there to set an honest pace and try to set things up for his teammate, Agincourt. Number two is the favorite, and here he is, A.P. Indy, won the Peter Pan, remember, on this track just 13 days ago. And the question is simply, has his hoof completely healed? Number three, the colt from the little California fairgrounds, Casual Lives. Should he win and take the $1 million bonus as well, no doubt he'll be one of the big sports stories of 1992, and he could do it. Number four is the Preakness winner, Pine Bluff. He raced at Belmont three times as a two-year-old, but never finished better than third here. Of course, he's a different colt today than he was then as a two-year-old. Now, number five is Al Sabine, Al Michaels' horse. Both his sire, Ali Dar, and his dam, Sabine, could go a mile and a half. Sixth in the Derby, he skipped the Preakness, comes here with 5 weeks rest. That could help. Now the long shot, number six, Jackson Port. He was claimed for $35,000 in January. He's the senior citizen's entry. Owner, trainer Murray Garden and Garin is 71 years old. Jockey Jean Cruguet is 53. From France comes number seven, Cristofori. Last month, he ran just about this distance at Longchamp and finished fourth. Jockey Steve Cawthon, once again, back from England for the day, hasn't ridden at Belmont since that hallowed day in 1978 when he won the Triple Crown. Here's the other foreign horse, number eight, My Memoirs. His new owners are American, and they had to put up an additional $50,000 supplementary entry fee to get him in this race. English bred, came from last place, remember, to win his last race in Britain. Number nine, Montreal Marty, would be the first New York bred to win the Belmont since Forrester in 1882. He's never won past a mile, has never won a race not restricted to New York breds. And rounding out the field is number 10, Colony Light. His daddy, Pleasant Colony, won the Derby and the Preakness, but finished third in the Belmont. Colony Light's only win was a maiden race, although he did finish first in the Louisiana Derby, but was disqualified and placed third. Jockey Julie Crone would be the first woman to win the Belmont. And speaking of women, here we are again with Charlesy. Charlesy, you know, we've been through two of the three Triple Crown races. We've had all the races leading up to them, and we still haven't really identified the star of this three-year-old season.
Well, we could find one today, but there are two key factors that'll have to be overcome: distance and track surface. They're going a mile and a half over an off track that's labeled good, and that leaves us with some unknowns. You know, horses are like airplanes. Some of them are faster. Some have greater range, and today's mile and a half is demanding of both, but only Cristofori has ever raced this far. But indications are that the big three should get the trip. Pine Bluff's running style and pedigree certainly indicate endurance, and after his Preakness victory, a track other than fast is certainly no problem, but he's never won at Belmont, which is his home court. Then we have AP Indy. He is the ultimate professional racehorse who should be unfazed by any race condition. His race in the Peter Pan was overwhelming, and if his foot problem's behind him, he'll be very tough to beat. And then there's Casual Lies. He's honest, consistent, and fit, but though he's bred for a classic race, he is yet to win beyond a mile in the 16th. His versatile running style will be a big asset today, though, Jim.
A quick pick.
I like AP Indy with big races from Colony Light and Al Sabine.
I like the foreign horses. If I have to pick one of them, I'll take My Memoirs.
So we'll see what's going to happen in the 124th running of the Belmont Stakes. It's coming right up.
A minute away from the listed post time for the Belmont now. The updated odds. The entry is 22-1. AP Indy is the clear-cut favorite at 6-5. You have co-second choices, Casual Eyes and Pine Bluff, each at 4-1. Al Sabine is now 20-1. Jackson Ford at 39-1. Christofori at 7-1. My Memoir is at 16-1. Montreal Marty, 21-1. And Colony Light at 19-1. Again, not only about $460,000 going to the winner of this total $760,000 purse, but Chrysler bonus points at stake. 10 for first, 5 for second, 3 for third, 1 for fourth, and just those two horses are still eligible. Pine Bluff leading Casual Eyes, 10 points to 8. If either horse wins the race, they would take the bonus. If Pine Bluff finishes ahead of Casual Eyes, he would take the bonus. There are a lot of scenarios where they could tie and split the bonus, or Casual Eyes, without a win, could win the bonus. But a lot of nervous energy being spent right now in the owner's boxes of Pine Bluff and Casual Eyes. And for that story, let's go to Jim.
John Ed Anthony. John Ed, what do you think your grandson, Mr. Garland, would think about this whole scene this spring?
Well, he would be amazed at what's transpired since he came on this earth, that's for sure.
Okay, well, good luck to you. Shelley Riley?
Yes.
Shelley, you've been handling this spring like you've been coming to Triple Crown races all your life. I'm not sure you think you know what's happened to you this spring.
Well, let's see what happens after this race, and I may suddenly become totally aware.
How about him being second choice, huh?
Sorry, I can't hear you.
Okay, thank you, Shelley, and good luck to you. Okay, so that's a little reaction in the owner's boxes, and the horses are starting to go into the gate for the 124th Belmont. Dave Johnson stands by upstairs. There you go, Dave.
Casual Eyes is in, and there's Pine Bluff. Al Sabine is next. And just behind the starting gate, the former claimer, Jackson Port. Jean Cougay won the Triple Crown. Seattle Sleuth. Here's Steve Cawthon with Christofori. Steve, of course, won the Triple Crown with the firm when he was 18 years old. Steve Cawthon behind the gate on Christofori. Steve is in. Post positions drawn by Lot. Agincourt, who wears saddle cloth one, is moving in, and his stablemate, Robert's Hero, is next in line. These are all three-year-olds. They all carry 126 pounds. My Memoirs with the red cap and Jerry Bailey, who won this race last year with Hansel. Montreal Marty, the New York Bred, and Julie Crone with Colony Light. 124th Belmont Stakes. We're ready for the start. A mile and a half. Sabine from between horses. Now Casual Lies shows quick early speed. AP Indy along the inside is next. Middle of the track. There goes Agincourt. They go to the clubhouse turn. Three of them across the track. AP Indy at the rail. Casual Lies between horses. And Agincourt on the outside caught three wide and losing a little ground. My Memoirs up close. Then Pine Bluff alongside in fifth. Al Sabine has been shuffled back into sixth position. On the inside, Christoforo. Around the turn and racing the backstretch, it's Casual Lies in front by three parts of a length. On the outside, that's Agincourt now charging up to challenge, and Pine Bluff makes a move. On the outside, third, AP Indy with Delahoussie content to sit fourth and save ground along the inside. It's four lengths farther back. My Memoirs is fifth. On the outside, Al Sabine is sixth. Christofori on the inside is next. Then comes Montreal Marty, followed on the outside by Colony Light, then Jackson Port, and the trailer is Robert's Hero. They continue down the backstretch. On the outside, it's Agincourt, the only horse in the race wearing mudcocks, leading it by half a length. Casual Lies, again on the inside, moves to challenge. Those two heads apart. A battle on the front end. Agincourt on the outside. Casual Lies at the rail. And Pine Bluff just sitting off the leaders, racing in third. Two off the front runner, Agincourt. Then along the outside, it's AP Indy, who has not been asked for his run yet. He's fifth. Cristofori on the inside is next. As they race around the far turn, it's still Casual Lies with an easy lead with Gary Stevens aboard in front by a head. Agincourt is second. Pine Bluff races third. On the outside, AP Indy is called for action. With his head low, he joins them. Four of them across the racetrack. My Memoirs racing fifth. And on the inside, Cristofori is next. They straighten away in the stretch, and Pine Bluff takes the lead ahead. On the outside, here comes AP Indy to challenge. They're in the stretch and coming to the eighth pole. AP Indy charges up on the outside. Pine Bluff at the rail. Pine Bluff with a short lead. AP Indy is second. My Memoirs is third. And down the stretch they come. Between horses, AP Indy with a head in front. Pine Bluff battling back. My Memoirs on the outside. AP Indy wins at 3/4 of a length. A photograph on the outside. It was My Memoirs and at the rail. Courageous race by these three outstanding horses coming home in the mile and a half in 2 minutes 26 seconds, tying the second fastest Belmont,
so
only Secretary
AP Indy. AP Indy has won a magnificent running of the Belmont Stakes. It's unofficial, of course, but in second place was the English bred My Memoirs, recently purchased by Americans, unofficially, and third was Pine Bluff. It's all unofficial. Whew. So it appears unofficially that Pine Bluff will win the $1 million bonus as Casual Lies faded. Charlesy, what did you think of that race?
Well, I think we've looked all over the world for a hero for racing, and we had the horse right here, AP Indy. Pine Bluff looked a winner when they came through the stretch. The big three turned for home together, but it was AP Indy and that laid-back, doggedly determined style of his. And he ground everybody down and won at the wire.
Okay. Eddie Delahousse, congratulations. The Cajun's done it again. I don't think Eddie hears this time. Pretty noisy, this crowd of 50,000 and more really still hooping it up. Eddie Delahousse, who won back-to-back Kentucky Derbies.
And there are the fractions, and AP Indy showed his good versatility. He was able to snap out of the gate, lay pretty close, wait when they picked it up down the backstretch, and when they turned for home, we'll watch them as they came through the stretch. Pine Bluff looked a clear winner. He had it. AP Indy coming along on the outside. Head low, we've talked all summer about spring, about shadow rolls. Pine Bluff wearing one. AP Indy carries his head the way you want a horse to carry. That's why you put a shadow roll on him. Head down, long, slow, smooth stride. And that's what probably makes the difference in the end. That wonderful way of going of AP Indy. He's the best three-year-old in the country. Only one narrow loss in his career. Seven straight victories.
AP Indy, owned by the Japanese businessman Tomonori Sudamaki, trained by the Englishman Neil Drysdale, and they've put it up, still unofficial, as 284. That's the way we had it for you. AP Indy, My Memoirs, Pine Bluff. And there's a look at the finish, still unofficial, so stand by. Much more to come at Belmont.
Back at Belmont Park now, the blanket of carnations has already adorned the back of the winner, AP Indy, who had done all of his racing in California prior to coming to the Peter Pan, but now he loves this track as he wins the Peter Pan 13 days ago, and we're going to isolate on him here. He went off, by the way, at even money. The results are not yet official, but he will pay either $4 or $4.20 as you take us down the stretch, Dave.
Eddie Delahousse, who's with AP Indy on the outside, knows how to win the Belmont. He did it with Risen Star. Let's watch him here. Pine Bluff is in front. Here's AP Indy. Here's the eventual horse that Steve Coffin rode, Christopher. But let's watch him down the backstretch, and let's watch the big move of AP Indy. Neil Drysdale did not compromise this horse by starting him too early. He ran him when he was ready, and he was ready in the Peter Pan, and he was even more ready this afternoon, going a mile and a half. McCarron getting all he could out of Pine Bluff on the inside. Reward of $1 million bonus isn't too bad. But here comes AP Indy, who really asserts himself at the head of the three-year-old class, Al, with this major victory in the Belmont Stakes.
So AP Indy ineligible for the Triple Crown bonus. Again, you must start and finish all three races, and he had to scratch from the Derby the morning of, rested during the Preakness period, came back in the Peter Pan, and wins here as we take a look at another look at the finish before we get to an isolated replay of the reactions of his connections.
By a Triple Crown winner, Seattle Slough, his maternal grandsire, Secretariat, winner of the Triple Crown. He just keeps grinding out these victories, going to the front when he wants and winning as he pleases. Eddie Delahousie in a hand ride, a big move by My Memoirs on the outside with Jerry Bailey, who won this race with Hansel last year. Not close enough at the wire. AP Indy the winner.
And the results are official. $420, $380, and $3. The payoffs on AP Indy. My Memoirs, who was sent off at 18-1, pays $1,160 and $660. And Pine Bluff, who went off at 7-2, $420 for the show. The $2 exact of 2-8, $73.20. As far as the bonus points are concerned in the Chrysler Triple Crown Challenge, Pine Bluff came in with 10. And Casual Eyes had 8. Pine Bluff, by virtue of finishing third, picks up 3 more and winds up as the winner of the $1 million bonus. Pine Bluff ridden by Chris McCarron, and he's with Charleston.
Well, Chris and I are just standing here watching the replay of how he had the Belmont in his grasp at the head of the stretch and it slipped away. Hard to watch, isn't it?
Yeah, it's difficult to watch when you get beat, but this colt, I was really proud of him. He ran so hard. We were able to get away with a nice leisurely half and three quarters, and when I called on him at the head of the lane, he gave me a nice response and a good feeling. I thought he was going to leave that horse, but when Eddie put the hammer down on his horse, he responded also.
Were you aware of how close AP Indy was getting to you?
Oh, absolutely. I knew who was right alongside me, and I got to the 3/8 pole over there, and I told Tom, I didn't really want to move when I did. You know, it's a mile and a half, and you want to move as late as you can sometimes. But I saw that Colt's white snip on his nose, and I knew who it was. So I said, it's time to go. I didn't want him to get a jump on me.
And then My Memoirs came up and stole second to
him. Yeah, you know, he did. He finished real strong. And Pine Bluff finished very strong also. He just got outrun for second money.
Well, it's been a good couple of races for you and Pine Bluff, Chris. Thanks a lot. We'll go back up to Al Michaels.
Okay, Charlie, despite the fact that yesterday the track was sloppy and today it was muddy until just before this race, it equals the second fastest Belmont in history. Secretariat with that scintillating 31-length triumph 19 years ago at 2:24, and then AP Indy and Easy Goer each came across the line in 2 minutes and 26 seconds. And here's a look at the order of finish, with AP Indy winning it by 3 parts of a length over My Memoirs, and that Jeff Siegel's amazing. He supplemented Marshall Law into the Santa Anita Handicap a couple of years ago and won that race. My Memoirs supplemented today, finishes second. Pine Bluff third. Cristofori, Casual Eyes, Colony Light, Agincourt, Montreal Marty, Robert Chiro, Al Sabine, and Jackson Port in that order. Tominori Suramaki paid $2.9 million for the horse. Here's his reaction. And the normally taciturn trainer, Neil Drysdale, I suppose will have his disposition brightened today as his horse, AP Indy, wins the Belmont Stakes. And our coverage will continue from New York after these messages and a word from our ABC stations.
The Travelers presents great Triple Crown finishes. Brought to you by The Travelers. You're better off under the umbrella. Sunday Silence won the first 2 legs of the 1989 Triple Crown, setting up an epic Belmont Stakes. Easy Goer, who had finished second to Sunday Silence in both the Kentucky Derby and the Preakness, was again the one to beat, trying to keep Sunday Silence from the coveted Triple Crown. They came together midway on the far turn, but this time it was Easy Goer pulling away. He spoiled the Triple Crown bid of Sunday Silence and traveled a mile and a half in the second fastest Belmont ever.
Back again at Belmont, and now I'm standing with the chairman of the New York Racing Association, Alan Dragone, for the official presentation to Mr. Tominori Suramaki.
Thank you, Jim. Mr. Suramaki, congratulations. On behalf of the New York Racing Association, we're pleased to give you this trophy, the August Belmont Memorial Cup, for winning the 124th Belmont Stakes. A marvelous, marvelous race. Got much to be proud of in that horse. Thank you.
We have an interpreter.
Yes, I did already.
What does he want to say?
I'm Chachananka, let's get that go.
He's
pleased to see himself here because Indy could not make a Kentucky Derby. He could not attend. So he is very much appreciated for all the audience here and the support.
Okay, congratulations to you. Congratulations to Neil Drysdale, who did a wonderful job of bringing this previously injured horse up to this race. And to the Cajun, Eddie Dalhousie, who did it again, your second Belmont. Congratulations, Eddie. We're going to take a look at a replay. It's from just about the far turn. Here we go. Want to move up and see if that...
Sure, Jim. He was laying third at that point, and I was just riding him and getting his confidence right there, and he was moving nice and easy, and he's a horse that's deceiving. You can be riding him, but he's still really not putting out as much as you really want him. Until I caught my stick, probably had headed
it. Give him a look at it.
Looked at it, and he kicked on. I don't know how many times I hit him. I didn't hit him that many times, but he really excelled when I did call on him, and he won by enough, and that's all that counted. And I think Neil's done a great job with this horse. I mean, coming back in 14 days, after running into Peter Pan to run a mile and a half, I owe all the credit to Neil, and we've been successful together, and he's a great trainer.
How about that My Memoir? Did you see him coming on the outside?
Yes, I did, but I knew the wire was there, and my horse, he was still digging, and it looked like we had him measured enough, and I think we could have went around again. I don't believe the other horse would have passed him.
Congratulations
again.
Thank
you, Jim.
Another look at the prices. And we'll be back for the presentation of the car keys to Eddie. So AP Indy was the winner of the Belmont Stakes, but Pine Bluff, with a third-place finish, got three more points in the Chrysler Triple Crown Challenge and wins the $1 million bonus. We have Steve Torek, the general manager of the Chrysler Plymouth Division, with the keys to a car.
Thanks, Jim. Eddie, congratulations on a great race and your second Belmont win. On behalf of Chrysler Corporation, I'd like you to present you with the keys to a 1993 Chrysler Concorde, our newest car, which will be on sale this fall. Great race.
Thank you very much, Jim. And this, I'm going to donate it to a good cause. And thank you very much. I really appreciate it. And I'd like to say hi to my wife, Juanita, and the whole family back in California and all my friends. And I want to thank Mr. Suramaki and Neil Drysdale for giving me a chance on APN. He's a great horse, and it's a shame he got hurt. I think he'd have won the Triple Crown.
Lots of jambalaya down in Cajun country tonight, huh?
Absolutely, Jim. Thank you.
Here is Neil Drysdale. You're known as a very low-key English gentleman, Neil, but you must be feeling a little emotion on this one.
Yeah, I'm very, very pleased for everybody concerned, for the horse, especially for Mrs. Uramaki and for the whole team, everybody that helped put the horse where he is today in the winner's circle.
Well, the way you brought him up to this race, passing the Derby, passing the Preakness, took a lot of self-control, but you had him for the race he was ready for. Congratulations. And now again, we're going to go back to Jack Whitaker.
Thank you very much, Jim. As this Triple Crown comes to a close, we find that the most royally bred of all the horses wins the last one. AP Indy's blood is bluer than a Billie Holiday song, and the road seems open for him to clinch three-year-old honors. However, I learned years ago never to judge the three-year-olds in June. It takes all year to do it. And our hope is that Arazi, and there's a rumor going around that Arazi will be retired soon, but we hope that's not true. We hope he comes back fit. We hope Ali Deed comes fresh from the Canadian Triple Crown, and AP Indy keeps his health, and all three meet down the line in one single race. That will take what has been a rather mediocre three-year-old year and turn it into an unforgettable one. And it would be a horse race that I'd pay a lot of money to see. Jim?
What are you doing for your first time? Here we are back again. We have another presentation, just $1 million, that's all. And that will be to the owners of Pine Bluff, of course. And here is Joe DeFrancis, the president of the Maryland Jockey Club, Alan Dragone, the chairman of the New York Racing Association, the masked forces of racing here. And, of course, Tom Meeker, the chairman of Churchill Downs and the president of Triple Crown Productions. Gentlemen, good to have you with us. Congratulations on an incredible three-race series again this spring. We have to bring in now Steve Torek again, general manager Chrysler Plymouth Division, with the big check.
Jim, we've been carrying this check around for the last month. It's a pleasure. John Ed, on behalf of Chrysler and its dealers, I'd like to award you $1 million as this year's winner of the Chrysler Triple Crown Challenge. Congratulations. Great horse. Great races. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you. Obviously, this is a great thrill for us. The colt ran a good race.
and we can't say enough good things about Chrysler's participation in this Triple Crown production series. Thank you so much.
If you'd like to know what it took to beat your horse today, AP Indy did the last quarter in 24-2 faster than Secretariat did. 24-4, I should say, faster than Secretariat did. So that was quite a race between great horses this afternoon. So that is about the story. We all started the springtime in Churchill, moved on to Pimlico with Joe DeFrancis, then with Alan Dragoon here to Belmont. The 124th running of the Belmont had to be one of the most exciting that there ever was. Many more races coming on ABC this summer. Please be with us for them. But right now, this is Jim McKay saying so long.